All right, wonderful. Welcome, everyone. We'll get started. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. My name is Laura Winning, and I am the educator for DuPage County Animal Services. Tonight, we are doing boredom busters for our canine buds. So things to do if you have an especially high energy dog, but also stuff that you can do with any dog. Before we dive in, just a little brief overview of what we're going to do tonight. First, we're going to talk about enrichment, what that is, and also stuff that you can do at home. We're going to talk about advanced training options, and then we've got a look at different clubs and organizations that you can join, especially some right here in the Chicagoland area. Little bit of housekeeping before we get started. If you have any questions, feel free to throw them into the chat box, but I will not check the chat box until the end of the presentation, okay? So, you know, feel free to throw a question in there at any time. Just know I won't see it until the end of the presentation, which should take about 50 to 55 minutes. Regardless, if you guys have questions, I'm going to stick around to get to all of those questions. So, you know, don't worry about that. We'll stick around as long as everybody has questions. Now, everybody should be set to mute. And please keep yourselves muted and keep your video off. We are recording this to share on our YouTube page. I'll also share the recording with everyone who registered. So, you know, don't worry if you miss something because you'll get the recording probably by tomorrow once I've edited it down. Just make sure you keep yourselves muted and your video off so that we don't have any lag time or any audio interference going on. I do have several videos I want to share with you guys, and Zoom doesn't love when I share videos and other people have their videos going. So I wish I could see your lovely smiling faces, but unfortunately Zoom doesn't like it when I do that. So please keep your videos off and keep yourselves muted. And just to show you where that chat is and how it works, I'm going to plug the link to our survey in there right now. So you should see a little red circle pop up to show you where that message is, show you where the chat box is. We use this survey to, one, give feedback on how we're doing, but also to get ideas for future programs. I think this program actually came from a survey response. So please, if there's something that you're particularly interested in learning about, we want to know what you guys want to know. So please share that with us. And hopefully at the end, I will remember to remind you guys to do that. Okay, so please bear with me. Sometimes I forget, but I will also send the survey link out when I send out the recording. So love hearing back from you guys. Now, with all that said, all that housekeeping out of the way, let's get started. We're going to start the evening out with talking about some fairly easy stuff that we can do at home and doesn't require, you know, schlepping across the county or buying a lot of equipment or anything like that. So when I talk about enrichment, it's really just a fancy term for letting animals be animals, letting them express their natural behaviors, but in a way that's not going to annoy us and not going to destroy our stuff. Okay. Because, you know, we think our dogs have the perfect life, right? They get to sleep all day. They get food delivered to them. I mean, that sounds like a perfect vacation. The problem with a perfect vacation is it can get boring pretty quickly. You know, this is not what animals, including human animals, are built to do. Just laze around all day and do nothing. While, you know, we're off doing stuff mentally and physically engaging with the world, and we expect our pets to just sit there, you know, in a nice, perfect little stay and do absolutely nothing all day. That's not how it works. That is incredibly hard to have such high expectations of our animals. So, of course, they get bored, you know, if you think about their ancestors out in the wild, they would spend so much of their time getting food, getting shelter, you know, getting those essential things that we've already provided for them. So we need to help them find other ways to fill the day. Or, as we said in kindergarten, we'll make our own fun. Okay, so animals will make their own fun, just like toddlers, just like teenagers of all species will. So it can lead to those undesirable behaviors that we see. Might include destroying stuff in the home. I remember one time I went to the grocery store. I had two puppies at home. Pro tip, don't ever get two puppies at the same time. Please learn from my mistake. I came home and it looked like it had snowed inside the house because the puppies had discovered a Kleenex box and how fun it was to individually pluck Kleenex out of the box and then rip all the Kleenex to shreds. So I'm sure that was great fun for them. And luckily it was just a Kleenex box that they destroyed. It was not great fun for me cleaning all that up. Okay. Now, on the other hand, they can actually hurt themselves trying to fill the time. That might be because they're destroying, they might be, you know, hurting themselves while they're destroying something, but it might also be something like constant scratching, constant licking. And, you know, it can lead to really bad skin irritations, things like that. Another sign of boredom that we really probably don't think about is when they're really, really clingy. Because we make up such a big part of their lives, they Velcro onto us as the end-all be-all of their mental and physical enrichment, okay? So when you have a dog that is just Velcroed to your side and is constantly, you know, like following you around and leaning up against you and always needing attention, that might be a sign that they see you as the only outlet and they're not getting enough outlets for their behaviors elsewhere in their life. Now, expressing natural behaviors obviously means work in our bodies, but it's a lot more than just exercise because we want to talk about physically as well as mentally engaging our animals. Now, a lot of enrichment items that you see in the store are those really confusing things that you have no idea what they're for, okay? So if you go to a pet store and you're in the toy aisle and you're like, what is this? Chances are it's an enrichment item. Now, those can get very expensive, so I'm not, you know, telling you, oh, go out and buy all the food puzzles, because a lot of this stuff can be made at home. And the great thing about our pets is, yeah, they're not necessarily going to care if it has a name brand on it or if it's all shiny and new or something like that. Okay. They're perfectly happy as long as it's engaging. And a major, major thing that we need to keep in mind with exploring enrichment is we need to listen to our pets. We need to make sure that it's enriching for them. So there are different senses that different breeds are more prone to paying attention to, right? So sighthounds pay attention to sight, typically. Scenthounds, as the name implies, really focused on their nose. You might need to do some mix and matching and just some trial and error to see which activities really engage your pets, because absolutely not all pets are the same. You know, I have, again, two puppies that came from the exact same family and they like completely different things. Same breed, same litter, they like completely different things. So when I use enrichment for one, I need to pay attention to see like, okay, does my other one, you know, is Cooper like that enrichment or do I need to do something different for him? So it's all about paying attention to your animal's level of engagement with these activities. You know, it's just like when you buy a really, really, really expensive toy for your kid and they care more about playing with the box. Kind of the same idea, right? We want to pay attention to what they're actually interested in. So if your dog is a digger, then something involving chasing movement, you know, in the air may not be as enticing for them. So one of the easiest ways to bring enrichment into our pretty much natural routines is to think about walks differently and allowing our dogs to fully experience the walk in the way that they want to. You know, when we walk as primates, we're up and we're physically moving our bodies and we're looking around. Maybe we're, you know, talking to the neighbors, or, you know, if you're walking with a partner, you're engaging with them. And, you know, a lot of the times the goal for the human is the movement. You know, we want to get our blood pumping. We want to get from point A to point B and then back. For the dog, they engage with the world completely different than how we do. I mean, when you think about it, dogs can be trained to smell cancer cells inside our bodies. No human can do that. So no human can fully appreciate how dogs perceive the world. They are really all about, a lot of them, taking in the smells and interacting with those smells, interpreting those smells, and even responding to those smells. You know, if your dog goes up to a fire hydrant that you can tell has been piddled on a few times and your dog has to piddle on it as well, well, that's kind of the equivalent of commenting on a Facebook post. They're like, I was here, this is my opinion, okay? So trying to prevent them from fully engaging in these smells really cuts off a lot of the mental exercise that you can get. And letting them follow their nose on a walk has many benefits, because sniffing itself increases endorphins. It releases those happy hormones. And it really does work their brain as they're interpreting those smells. Again, they're experiencing the world on a completely different level than we are. So yes, that one blade of grass may be fascinating, and it's not fascinating to us. And especially when it's cold out, we just want to keep moving so we can keep warm. But I'm telling you, letting them sniff to their heart's desire that one blade of grass can exhaust them mentally just as much as going for a run, okay? Because if you're relying solely on physical exercise to tire out your dog, what you're doing is conditioning an athlete, all right? So think about it. If I, in a fantasy world, run 1 mile every day, eventually that 1 mile is going to be super easy and I'll need to run 2 miles to get the same amount of physical exhaustion. Eventually that 2 miles is going to seem like nothing and I'm going to need to do more. So by incorporating the mental exercise into our sniffy walks, you're working different parts of the body, but you're still working them. It's like taking a really, really big test in school and how exhausting that was. Working the brain is just as exhausting as working the body. And when you let the dog choose which smells to follow, as long as it's safe to do so, you're also giving that dog choice. And all creatures like choice. That is a fact of life. We all like being able to choose what we do. And letting them choose, oh, this scent, I really want to follow this scent for a little bit and figure out where it ends. Giving them that choice, again, is going to increase their agency and give them more satisfaction with their daily lives. So there is my soapbox speech on sniffy walks, because it's just so funny how differently we perceive the world and how that difference interprets into completely different walking styles. So 100%, I know it's cold out there, bundle up, put on a good book on your phone, and let your dog sniff to their heart's content. You will not be sorry. Now, things that we can do inside are, or outside, depending on the weather, foraging and brain games. So this really goes into your pet's natural instinct to search for their food. Because, you know, out in the wild, dinner doesn't come on a plate. They have to look for it. So they are problem solving. trying to find the food. They're using their senses. And remember, sniffing releases those happy endorphins. And they're also immediately rewarding themselves for figuring something out. So, you know, instant karma right there. And what's great is there are so many ways to level it up. So if your pet becomes a pro at one type of food puzzle, there are lots of different ways to change it to up the challenge. So super, super easy. Like we see in the picture, you could just have a box with some crumpled up paper or some shredded up towels or even shredded t-shirts, and you sprinkle kibble in it. And they have to dig between the paper or the flour or the pieces of fabric to get those pieces of kibble. Or you can do closed containers that they can rip open. Fast food containers are perfect for this because they smell amazing and we don't care what happens to them. Okay. So, you know, the little cardboard box that your burger came in, put that on a shelf. The next day, put some kibble in it, close it up, and let your dog rip it to shreds. Shredding and ripping also releases those happy endorphins. Those are natural behaviors for our dogs. Going even easier, scatter feeding. So just throwing their kibble on the floor and letting them run around and find it. Going even bigger, you can do this out in the yard. What we like to call it at the animal shelter is a sushi roll or a treatsy roll. You roll up a towel with treats inside the roll. And there are lots of different ways to do this to make it harder. So you can fold the towel in half lengthwise, spread the kibble, and then roll it up so it's nice, short, and fat. Really easy to unroll. Once they mastered that, have the towel flat, roll it up from the short end. Once they've mastered that, roll it up from the long end so it's like a noodle. Really loose, floppy, takes them a little bit longer to unravel it. Once they master that, wrap it around itself. Then you can go to tying it in a knot. Then you can go to a couple towels tied together in a knot. There are so many ways that you can level this up. It's fabulous. And it is really, really fun to watch your dogs just go at it. Pro tip, make sure that you are using towels you don't care about, because 100% they will probably get nibbled on, and 1,000% they will get drooled on. And there also are those store-bought puzzle feeders. Now, with those, they tend to have a little bit more challenging right away. So sometimes you leave it completely open to start and just put the kibble in it so that your dog knows, okay, this contraption that you brought into the house, this contraption is the thing that has food in it. Okay. And these are the places where the food is. Then you can start adding like the covers or, you know, the tourney wheels and things like that one at a time to up it. Don't expect your pet, unless they are a pro forager, pro bang games solver, to be able to do one of those store-bought things right from the get-go. Because if you do have that expectation, it can be really frustrating for your pet, and they're not going to be excited about doing these things. It's just going to make them upset, make them frustrated. And we never, ever want to frustrate them. So with any of these activities, you may need to go back a step if you notice that your pet's having a hard time. So they're not figuring out how to unroll the towel, unroll it a little bit to reveal some of the treats. And if they're having problems with the closed cardboard containers, maybe have one end open or have a rip in one end so that they can see and get inside and figure out, oh yes, I'm allowed to destroy this. Super fun. Anytime you're doing these kinds of activities with your pet, make sure you're monitoring them though, because you never want them to get so enthusiastic that they bite off a piece of towel, because then you have a potential intestinal blockage, which can be very painful and very expensive to fix at the vet and very dangerous. So always make sure that you are supervising your pets when you're doing these, just to make sure that nothing accidentally goes down that was not supposed to. Now, for those animals who really like to move, there are some great tools you can use. And one that I had never heard of before I started working at the shelter is a flirt pole. And they do this, you can do this with all animals. I'm just using this for dogs, but you can use this for all animals that like to chase. And basically what it is you are creating a prey for your animal to chase, and you're keeping it at a distance from yourself, but able to control it, change directions, things like that. So we've got a little video here for you guys to see what that looks like. So you see, she's got not a huge yard, but she's got a good amount of space. The flirt poles do come in different lengths. You can also make this yourself with a piece of PVC pipe, some rope, and a toy on the end of it. Now, one thing I would suggest that she is not doing is to have something to switch out once they catch the lure. So some people have two flirt poles. So as soon as your dog catches the toy on one, you can have the other one going and they have something else to chase. Or you just, when they catch it, you have them drop it, you give them a treat, or you give them a different toy before you start again. And you can see how she can change directions really easily here. And the dog has to pay attention. Where did the toy go? Where did the toy go? So depending on the size of your dog and, you know, the length of your arm, you may need to try a few sizes to see what works best for you, your dog, and the space that you have. Now, the goal is that they catch it, they enjoy that they catch it, and then they drop it, and then we chase again. The goal is not to play tug. So you'll notice that she never like tries to pull it out of the mouth or anything like that. She just waits for them to drop it before the game can start again. Sometimes when we're just beginning this, it can be a little hard for them to understand that game, which is why I recommend having the treats there, because you can't eat a treat when you have a toy in your mouth. And if your dog isn't super food motivated, use something that's really, really high value and stinky, maybe, you know, hot dogs, cheese, something like that to start until they get what the game is. Okay, so moving on to advanced training. So this is beyond your basic commands of sit, stay, paw. You know, this is going above and beyond. And one that we talk about in our basic training 101 class, we do cover this, but I caution against beginning trainers doing this. It is called shaping. And the idea behind shaping is that it teaches advanced tasks. So think of your service dogs. You know, the dog was just not automatically trained to go open the fridge door, get a bottle of water, and bring it. Instead, they taught the dog how to do those things in stages. So the first stage may have been go to the refrigerator door. The second stage may have been grab onto the handle. Third stage, open, so on and so forth. So they broke the task they wanted done down into small steps. They taught each step at a time and then combined it all together. So you do need to think about what your goal is and think about how you can break it down. Now, one thing to keep in mind here is you definitely want to keep this fun, because if you try to go too fast, it can be very frustrating for your dog because they're jumbling and they're not sure. So you're not going to teach your dog to go get a bottle of water from the fridge in one afternoon. Okay. This is something that's going to take several short sessions over many, many days. So don't expect to be able to go from A all the way to Z in just one short training session. You definitely want to pay attention to your dog's frustration levels. And if they're having problems picking up that next step, Go back down to a step they mastered and make sure to reward them for that to build up their confidence again. And keep in mind that, yes, you want to have a plan, but your plan will probably need to change as you go through this. Now, a variation on shaping is also called reshaping. So you're looking to see what behaviors the dog offers, and you're rewarding the ones that lead to your goal. So this is Dr. Sophia Yen. She was a master in dog everything, dog training, dog psychology, everything. So she is teaching her dog a specific task, and The dog does it very quickly because this is a very intelligent dog and they work very well together. So we're going to take a look at this video of Sophia Yen and her dog.
In this demo, I'm going to have my dog put her front feet in the box, but I'm not going to tell her what I want. Watch and see if you can tell how she learns.
So you can see she wants the dog to interact with the box, so she's rewarding the dog for even going near the box. So that's the first step that she's chosen. Now the dog is like, okay, what do you want me to do with the box? Okay, I'm going to touch it. So that's good. She rewards that. Now, as the dog has figured out, okay, I need to touch the box, Sophia is going to up at the ante, like, no, I need you to do something a little bit more, which is why she didn't reward right away. But you can see, so the dog put the foot in, and that was rewarded. So now the dog's trying to figure out, okay, what do you want me to do next?
Yes.
Foot in the box works. Okay, that's how I get my cookie. Can you continue working? So this is advanced stuff, guys. And there are lots of things online that you can use to help guide you through this process. 101 things to do with a box is there. Now you can see the dog's getting a little confused, a little frustrated. Like, well, I put my foot in there. Why am I not getting rewarded? And see, he's kind of disengaging a little bit. Like, I don't know. So then she goes back a little bit of a step. And the next time she engages. Goes ahead and rewards her. Even though that's something that we had moved on from, you could see the dog was getting a little frustrated. So wanted to continue to build that confidence that, yes, this is the right path. There we go.
Have you figured it out yet?
So, like I said, that is advanced stuff. So don't feel bad if you can't accomplish that in just a 5-minute training session. I couldn't. That is something that I would need to work with my dogs to get them to the point where they felt confident to experiment and figure out what I was looking for. But you can really see how that dog's brain was very engaged. They were really problem solving and trying to figure things out. That dog was going to have a great nap later on that day. Now, in addition to advanced things that you can do at home, if you need a little bit more guidance, there are groups that can do certifications, so trick titles is one of those. So this is through the American Kennel Club. But it is open to all dogs. It does not need to be a purebred dog. You just need to fill out the application. You need to do documentation on the tricks and you need to have it evaluated. So typically they're gonna have you record, or if there is an evaluator nearby, then they'll have you do it in front of an evaluator. But I believe since the pandemic, they've been allowing video submissions. And tricks can range from covering their eyes or a pretty sit that you see here in the picture, walking backwards, making their bed, doing a handstand. I mean, there's all sorts of different things here. So if you just like, oh, I want to train my dog to do things, but I have no idea what to do. And I don't even know how do you teach this particular trick? You know, how do you teach a dog to walk backwards? This can be a way to give you a little bit of guidance. And if you find out that you and your dog are really awesome at it, then 100% go for your trick title, because that is super, super fun and cute and something to show off at parties. Now, again, with organized clubs that you can do, dog scouts which I just discovered was a thing and I'm very excited about, because look at those handsome doggies in their patches. Anybody who knows me knows I have a patch problem, so I'm very excited about this. The idea for Dog Scouts, I love their mission because their whole focus is strengthening the bond between the owner and the dog. So this isn't something that you take your dog to a camp, you drop them off, they teach the dog everything, and you get your dog back, and bam, they know a whole bunch of new tricks. No, this is all about working together and increasing the strength of the owner's training ability. Okay. Now, what's great about this is that they're also looking about, you know, preventing those behavior problems from boredom and, you know, teaching owners how to better understand their pets and making sure that the dogs are living well-rounded lives. They also do give back to the community through outreach about dog training and about dog and people relationships. They are located throughout the United States, but unfortunately, we do not have a club in Illinois, but we are surrounded by clubs. And the one in Michigan does week-long camps in the summertime. So this, if you're interested in looking into and you've always thought, man, I wish I could go back to summer camp, but bring my dog with me, we have got the place for you. So you can check out the website, just Google Dog Scouts Michigan Club and see what it all entails. But again, this is a way, even if you're not interested in joining the organization, you can see what patches the dogs work for, and it can kind of give you an idea of what to do with your dog. So now let's go into professional clubs and professional sports. So we've got a lot of videos here to show you because some of them are very hard to explain. You just kind of have to see them. So probably one of the most familiar dog sports is going to be the herding sports. So that's the sheepdog trials. The movie Babe, where the pig goes and moves the sheep from one circle to another circle, that's a sheepdog trial. And that's been around for a very long time. It came out of New Zealand in the 1860s. Yeah, it's been around for a long time. Tribal is where your dog is herding like those giant yoga balls. Okay, so oversized inflatable balls, and they're trying to get them into a goal within a certain time frame. Schützen, or IPO or IGP, is a sport that tests a dog's tracking, obedience, and protection skills. And it evaluates working dog characteristics. So when you think like military dogs, police dogs, things like that, it's evaluating those. So I do have a video so that you can see of the IGP championship 2 years ago in Fredericksburg, Pennsylvania. So I did mute it so you guys wouldn't have to listen to all the wind sounds, but basically there are blinds set up in the field that the dog has to investigate and has to make sure that nobody's hiding in those, and he's going back and checking in on his owner and waiting for the cues, and the owner is like, oh, go check this one, go check this one. And then, you know, oh, I just love how happy this dog looks, like, I'm protecting my owner, woo! And as he goes through the field, then he can make sure that his owner is safe as the owner walks from one end of the field to the other by checking all these blinds. Now, there will be volunteers hiding in these blinds, and it's not predetermined, so it could be anyone. And then the dog's job is to alert stranger danger right here, okay? And he will alert until the owner calls him off. So he doesn't engage with the stranger, he's just alerting. Now, another part of the competition is that protection skill, which is why the volunteer has that giant, big, fluffy arm. So the animal is taught how to do that controlled bite takedown of the volunteer as well. So lots of things going on there. I just love how happy that dog looks when he's running all over the field protecting his owner. So herding and schutzen are activities that you see here in the Chicagoland area. So if I have a little asterisk by the name, that means that there are active clubs here in the area that we're aware of. Some of these may have unofficial clubs or something like that that we're not aware of. It doesn't mean that they're not, you can't do these in the area. It just means that I'm not aware of official clubs. So besides herding, probably the next most famous one is obedience. So heel work set to music. So for those who are not familiar with the term, heeling is where you have your dog. Traditionally, it's on your left-hand side and they are walking parallel with you. Okay. So probably not without a leash, and they stay within 6 inches of your leg. Okay, so they are right there and they are matching your stride and they are not leaving your side. So heel work to music is a little bit of dancing with the dog at your side. Okay, musical canine freestyle 100% is dancing with your dog, and we will see a video of that later, I promise. Then an obedience trial, exactly what it sounds like. You're going through different assigned tasks and seeing how well your dog complies with those assignments. Now, rally obedience is a little bit different because it's a course. So a dog and their handler moves together through a course, and the course is made up of 10 to 20 signs. And the signs have a skill to perform. So it could be a behavior like sit, down, stay, turn, something like that. And at each sign, the dog and the handler need to do the correct skill and then move on to the next. So we've got an example of this cute little floofies doing a rally here. So you can see here's the judge in the very sensible shoes, bringing them out to the course. And here's the first one, and it is possibly a sit. And then they move on to the next one. And that's a walking turn, moving on to the next one, and so forth and so on. Now, I will say that this dog got 100 score. So they started 100 and then they mark off points for, you know, losing focus or, you know, not being able to do the skill performed, or the handler needing to pull tightly on the leash to keep the dog at their side. So you start at 100 and you go down. This dog never lost any points and ended with a perfect 100. And is very, very cute. Now, for the more athletic amongst us, good for you, there are athletic sports that you can do with your dog, mostly pulling. So bike joring is where the human is on the bike and the dog is running along beside or in front, pulling the bike. Canicross is where the human is running and the dog is in a specially designed harness that attaches typically to your waist and the dog is pulling you as you're running. Carting, they're pulling a cart. Dog scootering, they're pulling you on a scooter. Mushing is the traditional sled dog that we all think of. Ski joring is what we're going to see here. So the human is on skis and the dog is pulling. Weight pulling is where the human is not involved and they're just pulling different size weights, maybe even in a cart. So carting could be with people in the cart or just with weights in the cart. So this is really fun. This is from the 2017 International Federation of Sled Dog Sports World Championship, and this is from the American team. It was a roughly 4-mile course. It was a relay, so it started with the one dog ski joring, which is what we'll see, one dog pulling a person on skis. Then it's two dog ski jore, which is two dogs pulling a person on skis, and then finally four dogs pulling a person on a sled. And for those of you feeling patriotic, the U.S. team finished 4th in this particular year. So we're going to take a look and you'll see this. So they have the start line and you'll notice that while everybody is still here at the beginning, kind of close to the start area, they keep the dogs pretty close because the last thing you want is for you to let your dog go and then everybody gets all tangled up. So you have to be able to keep a pretty good hand as you get started. And yes, this requires that you be much better at skiing than I am. And then you can see that the dogs are just, boom, taking the lead and going out. And it's absolutely fabulous. Another famous one that we're pretty all familiar with, racing sports. So Greyhound probably being the most well-known, but other breeds participate as well. For obvious reasons, they do it typically by breed, because the last thing you want is a wiener dog going against a Greyhound or a Jack Russell Terrier going up against a Husky, because that would just not be fair. And I do have from the Houston Texans, they do wiener dog races at halftime, and I absolutely love it. So I kept the sound on this one. Hopefully you can hear it, because of course the dachshunds have fabulous names. So we'll take a look at that.
It's the third annual Wiener Dog Races. The dogs will compete in two heats, with the winner of each race going on to compete in the finals. Let's meet our racers in heat one. In lane one, Luna. Frederick Footlong is manning lane two. Peanut in lane three. In lane four, Jack. And Lady is in lane five. Pick your racer. On your mark, get set, go! Look at them go! Look at those little legs churn. Look at those wieners run.
Okay, so we won't watch the other races. One thing I wanted you to notice, though, was, you know, this particular race was not in a track like what they do with Greyhounds. Instead, it was just an open field. You had owner at one end holding the dog and releasing, owner at the other end receiving. So if you're interested in doing these particular types of races, they have them all over the place. And, you know, a lot of times they're not even breed specific. They might be size specific. So at an event that I went to recently in Hanover Park, they had one, and it was like under 20 pounds went. And it was just a big open field. So a tiny little poodle mix thing was enjoying the race so much that she ran the length of the field three times and did not care that her owners were calling her. So absolutely work on your recall to make sure that when the race is over, your animal will come to you for safety reasons. So a lot of times with these sports, making sure that your animal has the basics down, and I mean, they can do those basics in the home with you, outside the home with you, at a very distracting location like a dog park with you, and also somewhere else with someone else. So making sure that they know that come means for them to come towards you no matter where they are, no matter what the situation is going on, because that'll help prevent any potential, you know, hazards or anything like that going on. Tracking and hunting sports aren't as common, I would say, with the general dog population. Barn hunt is what we'll see a video of here, and it's searching for a mouse in a tube in bales of hay. And yes, you heard me correctly. Some of it is a little bit more specific to certain breeds. So coon hunting field trial, exactly what it sounds like. Earth dog is where tiny little dogs are sent into tunnels underground. Hare coursing, following a rabbit or a rabbit skin. Hound trailing, like what you see the bloodhounds doing on TV for the police. They're following a scent and making sure that they hit different marks. Lure coursing is also known as fast cat. So it's like a 100-yard dash and they are chasing something on a lure. We'll see a video of that. Nose work is being able to find an object scented in a particular way. So it can be just PVC pipes, and most of them are empty, but one has some lavender in it, and finding that and retrieving it. Tracking trial and trail hunting, very similar to the hound trailing. So let's take a look at this barn hunt. So right now, the dog, this is the first time this dog is doing this, has to identify the tube that has rat essence in it. It has some droppings and things like that. once they successfully do that, they can move on to where the tube is, and it does have a live rat. Now, these rats are pets of the people running it, and your dog will be 1,000% disqualified if they go nuts at the rat and cause the rat any distress. So the rat is just in its little home and it's hidden and it's probably got some treats for, you know, to hang out in. And if your dog starts barking, pawing, or trying to pick up, then you are disqualified and you are immediately escorted away because they do not want to cause the rats any distress. So this dog appropriately alerts the owner. Oh, I think it's here. I think this is where it is. And the owner looks and yep, the rat is in that particular tube. Now, I will say that she should have immediately engaged with her dog to let her dog know that the dog did right. You know, that's immediately what they should have done. Lure coursing can be really fun. The picture on the right here is actually my dog. I did not get a video of my dog doing it. This is Cooper because I was holding him, so I couldn't get a video of him. And my husband was on the other side of the field getting fabulous photos like this one, which I have nicknamed the wee photo. So all it is you can see here on the screen, those little white things are just plastic bags. And while you're holding your dog, the operator will move the bags back and forth to get your pet's attention. And then once your pet has fully focused on the bags, they will start the course and you let go. Let's take a look at that. So there goes the bags, there goes the dog. So this particular dog, I think this was her first time doing this, and you'll see she follows for a good amount of time. This is a big field. But then about halfway through, she's like, no, I think I'm gonna go back. So they try to put the bags back and forth to re-engage her, but she's way more interested in hanging out with mom. That's okay. It was still an enriching experience. Your dog does not need to win blue ribbons for it to be fun, engaging. And again, you can get fabulous photos like these. So just so you know, you do not have to win anything for it to be a great experience. We're also going to talk about water sports. Now, there's not as many around here because we are limited with our seasons, but dock jumping, which we'll see, dog surfing, that one's pretty obvious, and water rescue. So water rescue is just what it sounds like, where the dog is trying to go into the water, retrieve a dummy or a person, and bring them back to safety. So we'll take a look at dock jumping. There are a couple different styles. There's one where the item is suspended above the water, and I just love how beautiful that dog is when it jumps. Or there are ones where the item they're supposed to retrieve is at the end of the pool and they do have to swim and get it. So, I mean, this dog was featured on ESPN, so do not compare your dog to this dog because it's just way on top of its game there. Okay, last we're going to talk about other sports. Agility is one that you see a lot on ESPN. We'll see a video of that. Disc dog is having your dog do various tricks while catching a frisbee. Fly ball is where it's a relay, so typically four dogs on a team. They're going over a series of hurdles and putting their paws on a platform that releases a ball. They grab the ball and then they go back over the hurdles and then the next dog does it. So four jumps, they get the ball, they go back over the four jumps and then the next dog. Dog puller is a specific kind of equipment that your dog is either running and jumping to get to it, or you're throwing it and the dog is returning it. So let's take a look at agility because we do have quite a bit of that here in the area. And as you can see, any dog can do agility. You don't have to have a big, crazy, Australian Shepherd. You can have a cute little Papillon. So weave poles, they can go up and down ramps, through tunnels, all sorts of fun things. And then over hurdles, lots of fun stuff that can happen there. Now, I want to end tonight by saying, you know, make sure that you're having fun with this. Again, you're not trying to necessarily win every competition. You want to make sure that you're having fun and that your animal is having fun. So using positive reinforcement, you know, rewarding them with things that they enjoy, whether that's treats, whether that's, you know, cuddle time with you, whether that's a particular toy, and letting them set the pace, paying attention to when they're frustrated, and absolutely take breaks. You know, go back to something easy that they know. Like if they are really great at sitting or, you know, jumping up into the air to catch something, do that in between, just so that they have something that, yes, I know I can do this. You know, everybody likes to feel satisfied with a job well done. And it can get frustrating if you're continuously trying to push one activity that they're just not getting. It may be you need to break that down into smaller bits for your animal to get to it, and that's okay. And if you're interested in joining these organizations, a lot of them have like trial days where you can just come and try it. You don't know if your dog's going to be engaged in this until you try it. So the lure coursing, I was pretty sure Cooper would love that because he loves chasing things around the yard, but I didn't know. So I just went to a free practice day where I could sign up for a time slot and then just do it with him and get feedback on, okay, how do I do this? I don't know what I'm doing. And that's okay. So, you know, there are organizations in the area that you can talk with, but also talk to your canine professionals, talk to trainers, veterinarians, groomers, or talk to us. We have a lot of volunteer resources and ties within the community to help find these things. Okay. So absolutely reach out to us if you are interested in any of these activities, and we will try to see if we can hook you up with somebody that either knows more or knows of an organization for you to engage with. And 100%, always make sure that you're having fun. So I wanted to end the night on just this adorable little video of people dancing with their dogs.
Love don't come easy, but I keep on waiting. I'm just waiting for that soft voice to talk to me at night, for some tender arms to hold me tight. I keep waiting, I keep on waiting.
Okay. Well, that was just fun and adorable. Okay, folks, that is the end of the presentation. We will get to questions in just a second. So if you have any, please feel free to throw them into the chat box and I will look at them in just a minute. While you're doing that, just a plug, we do have some upcoming webinars. So if you're more looking for things that you can do at home, we are doing a do-it-yourself enrichment, and this is for dogs, cats, rabbits, whatever you have in your home. So all animals can benefit from enrichment, and we've got great ideas of things that you can do on the cheap and on the easy to engage your pet every single day and make sure that they have a nice, well-rounded life. So I hope you join us for that webinar in 2 weeks. And then in the month of February, we've got some information on fostering. So if you are a current foster, either through our organization or through a different organization, we've got some pointers on how to set your foster animal and your household up for success. So join us for that. That's going to be the first week of February. The third week of February, we're going to have our basic pet first aid. And sneak peek, tomorrow on Facebook, I will be posting the workshop. So the in-person workshop for our pet first aid. We have a couple of in-person classes coming up, and that does come with a certificate of completion. So in addition to the stuff that we learn in the webinar, we also do hands-on stuff like bandaging, choking, and CPR and rescue breaths. So we do that as well in the hands-on workshop. So I will be posting sign-up information to those on Facebook tomorrow. So keep your eyes peeled for that. But if you are not available to come to one of the in-person workshops, we still cover a lot of great information on the basic pet first aid. So I hope to see you guys at one or more of those webinars in the future. And if at any point you have questions, please feel free to reach out to us. You know, at DuPage County Animal Services, our goal is for all the animals in DuPage County to live harmoniously with the people of DuPage County. Okay, so we want to make sure that if you're having problems, you know, reach out to us, troubleshoot with us. If we don't have the answer, again, we have lots of ties in the pet professional world that we can link you up with to troubleshoot and find solutions. There is no question that we haven't gotten before that, well, I should say there's no stupid question we haven't gotten before, and there's no such thing as a stupid question. Trust me, I started in this field a few years ago. I'm always asking stupid questions because that is how you learn. And I am 100% a believer that we learn something new every single day. And if you learn something new about your pets, it's going to make life so much better. So absolutely reach out to us. You can reach out to me directly by emailing humane.education@dupageco.org. Or you can reach out to the shelter during business hours, 630-407-2800. Again, we are happy to answer any questions that you have. I don't see any questions in the chat box at the moment, but I am going to hang out here for just a little bit in case anybody has one. I'm also going to throw that link to our program survey back into the chat box. Please feel free, guys. I love getting information on what you want to learn about. So absolutely let me know how we're doing and ideas for future programs. We love to know that as well. All right, so I'm going to hang out here. I'm going to get some water. If anybody has any questions, feel free to throw them into the chat. Thank you so much for coming, everyone. I really appreciate it. I hope you had a great evening. And again, if you're having issues with the chat or you come up with a question later, feel free to reach out to me. I will be emailing all registrants tomorrow to give them the link and also further information. So thank you so much. Have a great rest of your night, and I hope to see you at a future webinar. Bye, guys.